Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Thank you very much for your patience. We will start right now. It is my pleasure to welcome you today for this great event. My name is Aude Jehan. I am a French Embassy Fellow at the Center for Transatlantic Relations here at SAIS. To launch the French Embassy Rendezvous, which is a conference series in partnership, of course, with the French Embassy, the Center for Transatlantic Relations, and the Alliance Française, we decided, of course, as a premier rendezvous, and as you know, in French, there is a double meaning between first business meeting or first date, and a premier rendezvous is always very important, so we decided, of course, for this series, to choose a very important topic of common interest to us. So the Arab Awakening. The Arab Awakening and the rapidity of the events which altered the face of the Middle East last year have called into question the ability of political analysis to provide the necessary tools for understanding the global scenario and its underlying trends. Civil society has been confronted with several constitutional, institutional, and socio-economic issues. More than 1 year after the revolutions, this conference will question the challenges of democracy in a new civil society, but also the impact of the Arab Spring on the US and the EU and the whole Middle East. We will also look at the economic challenges, and I would like to deeply thank Minister Dimassi, the Tunisian Minister of Finance, for his presence today. Minister Dimassi had an important meeting in Washington, and he made space in his agenda to be our guest today. Monsieur le Ministre, merci infiniment pour votre présence. I would like also to thank deeply His Excellency Ambassador Delattre for his support for this wonderful project, Mrs. Emilienne Banet Nouayetas, the higher education attaché at the French Embassy, and Mr. Thomas Chorin, the Executive Director of the Alliance Française. The series of seminars which we inaugurate today aim to highlight the work of outstanding researchers and academics on contemporary questions here in Washington, D.C. Rather than a conference series, let's say, the French Embassy Rendezvous is a forum for working progress. So I give the floor to our moderator today, Ambassador Kurt Volker. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. It's my pleasure to be here and to have an opportunity to introduce our guest speakers. As Aude indicated, I'm a senior fellow here at the Center for Transatlantic Relations, and I want to say a welcome to all of you, and especially a few friends I see in the audience, Andra Shimoni, who is our managing director now at the Center for Transatlantic Relations, Ambassador Bob Beecroft, Ambassador Serjan Darmanovic from Montenegro, and I'm sure there are a few who I've missed here. I want to start out with one suggestion and then turn to our first speaker. The suggestion that I would make, and I'd like each of you to give it some thought, is that the transformation that began in Tunisia and that is taking place throughout the Arab world right now is, I would say without doubt, the most significant political development that has taken place in our lives, in our observation, since the fall of the Berlin Wall. It is on that scale of importance. If you think about it that way, and then you look at the way the United States or Europe or any of our international organizations or the UN are dealing with this change in the Arab world, we're not acting as though that is the most significant development in the last 25 years and in our modern political lifetimes. And I think that is a challenge to us. A challenge for us to think a little bit more ambitiously, a little bit more assertively in terms of resources, in terms of engagements and commitments, a little bit more structurally in terms of the way we build support for change in the Middle East, the way we engage our international organizations. One need only look at the example of Syria today, where thousands of people have been killed by a dictator who is trying to cling to power, where the people in that country are asking for the very same things that the people of Tunisia asked for just over a year ago. The results thus far are very, very different. And I think that that does put a premium on us around the world and the international community to think very carefully about how we are managing and how we are supporting this most significant change that is happening right before our eyes. With that in mind, I think the initiative of Odd, our fellow here at CTR, together with the French ambassador, Ambassador Delattre, and the Tunisian ambassador, Ambassador Tekaya, to focus on one of the relative success stories of the North African, Middle East, Tunisia, is particularly important, because we need these success stories and these models to show that there is a path that responds to the wishes of the majority of people in the broader Middle East region. And that's a wish not to be trapped either by authoritarian governments or by Islamist extremism, but rather to be given the opportunity to shape their own government, to experience greater human freedom, to experience greater justice in society, and the ability to start building a more modern and successful society. That kind of model is necessary for the entire Middle East, and I think it is something that we do well to study and to support. And with that in mind, I want to then turn to our speakers, and then I'll look forward to moderating the discussion. And if I could turn first to our friend and supporter and colleague, the Ambassador of France to the United States, François Delattre.
Thank you, Ambassador. Thank you, Kurt, for your kind words. Can you hear me? Good. It's a good start. It's a truly great honor for part of my team here and for me to be here with you today and to have the opportunity to speak to such a distinguished audience with such highly qualified co-speakers. And it's a particular privilege to welcome Minister Houcine Dimassi, Minister of Finance of the Republic of Tunisia. Monsieur le Ministre, your presence honors us all. A warm welcome also to my Tunisian colleague, Ambassador Mohamed Saleh Tekaya, who is doing a superb job here in Washington. I would like to say how delighted I am to inaugurate this new initiative today, the French Embassy Rendezvous, a somewhat glamorous title for a very serious endeavor. And I want to thank the Center for Transatlantic Relations at Johns Hopkins University, SAIS, and its Executive Director, Dan Hamilton. A special word of thanks also to Ambassador Kurt Volker for his commitment, and of course to Aude Géant, our fellow at SAIS, for launching this program. I know Aude's mother and husband are with us today, and frankly, you are lucky because she's doing an outstanding job here at the center and with the embassy. And by the way, the Center for Transatlantic Relations is a key player in this field, the Transatlantic Partnership, and a great partner for the embassy. I'll keep my introduction fairly short because I'm eager, as all of you are, to listen to Minister Dimassi and our panelists. I've been asked to give you today the French perspective on the Arab Spring. It's not the easiest time for me to do so, for two reasons. First, because in the Arab world, we seem to hear little good news these days, and rather bad news, or at least tremendous uncertainty, from Syria to Egypt, from Bahrain to Yemen. The revolutions already seem far away, and we are now in the middle of transitions that are inevitably difficult and challenging. I should have also welcomed, by the way, Tony Smith, former president of the French-American Foundation, as well as Andrew Pierre and many friends and familiar faces. The second reason why it's not so easy for me to speak about the Arab awakening today is because France, as you probably know, is now 4 days away from the first round of our presidential elections, which is the defining election for our domestic as well as our foreign policy. This being said, I would like to make two remarks from the outset that I believe are a matter of consensus in my country. First, I believe it's important to put things into perspective. There is instability and uncertainty in the Arab world, but should we miss the times of Ben Ali, Mubarak, Gaddafi? I don't think so. It would be morally wrong. It would be strategically wrong, because we now see that the stability these regimes were providing was fake. And it would be irrelevant, because whatever we think about it, the Arab awakening is here. And that's why France has been, from the beginning, at the forefront of international efforts to promote the democratic movements in the Arab world, based on the values that are the core of our DNA, based also on our strategic, longer-term interests. And that's my second point. The real question for us now is not what we think of the future of the Arab Spring, but what we do about it. And I believe that when you look at the issue from this angle, you end up identifying similar prescriptions, regardless of whether you are skeptical or enthusiastic about the future. So what are these policy prescriptions that we draw from the last 14 months? Let me mention a few with the traditional, well-known and wide French modesty, as you know. First, the most immediate one. Our policy must incorporate the fact that regimes that ignore their society's aspirations are bound to collapse. This seems obvious in retrospect, but if you think about it, Tunisia did not seem the most unstable country in the Middle East in December 2010. So we must thank Tunisia as the pioneer of the Arab awakening for having reminded us this very basic truth. And we must keep in mind, when dealing with regimes in the Middle East and elsewhere who still resist change, we may engage them, but we should not overestimate nor over-legitimize them. I'm thinking of Iran in particular, where you had in 2009 the beginning of a Persian Spring. Conversely, it's important for us to encourage the countries who have chosen the path of reform. Morocco is, I believe, a good example in this respect. As for regimes who do contemplate reforms but may feel it is better to wait for better times, we must convince them that earlier is actually better. I also believe that these convincing should not come only from us, but more importantly and more efficiently from Arab transitioning countries themselves. Second, wherever we have an opportunity to engage a wide spectrum of new actors, we must seize it. Some countries in transition are still inward-looking, but some are open and eager to develop relations with us, France, Europe, the United States in particular. And this is certainly the case with Libya and Tunisia, where there is now an almost constant stream of visits and exchanges. I think we French had something like 15 bilateral visits with Tunisia in the last year, which is totally unprecedented. This is crucial because the future and the resilience of our relationship will depend on these networks that we are building now. On the potentially hot issue of Islamism, I should point out that French authorities have openly and repeatedly explained that we were fully willing to engage Islamist parties so long as they respect the rules of the democratic game, as is, for instance, the case in Tunisia. Third, we must be prepared for a genuine partnership with the Arab world, We have been trying to do so for a number of years through the Euro-Mediterranean Partnership and the Union for the Mediterranean in particular. We now have the Deauville Partnership that was established last year under the French chairmanship of the G8. But let's be candid, we still have a lot to do to move from a donor's logic to a true partnership whereby goals and implementation are defined together with clear commitments from both sides in our mutual interests. That's how we will be able to use efficiently the resources that have been pledged until the Deauville Partnership. You know that we together have identified up to $70 billion from bilateral and multilateral donors in support of reforms in Egypt, Tunisia, Jordan, and Morocco. We must continue, it's not easy, of course, but we must continue working together to build good working relationship and attractive frameworks of cooperation. And I would like to praise here the US work in this regard as current president of the G8. There is no doubt this will continue to be an issue of high priority for the European Union and one for the next French authorities. Fourth and lastly, we, the United States and Europe, must reinforce our commitment to addressing major regional crises that can threaten the future of the Arab awakening. The first one is, of course, Iran. A nuclear-armed Iran is unacceptable because it would be an immediate threat to the security of Israel, but also because it would endanger the security and stability of the whole region, and because it would mean the demise of the international non-proliferation regime that we together patiently built over the last decades. And I don't see, by the way, how a nuclear-armed Iran with emboldened proxies throughout the region could possibly have any positive influence on the Arab Spring. Our task is therefore to prevent such an outcome, and we are doing everything we can to do so peacefully through an unprecedented level of sanctions vis-à-vis Iran in particular. As you know, what we call the 5+1 had their first meeting in a long time with Iran last Saturday in Istanbul, and we are now looking for another more substantive meeting in Baghdad at the end of May. So Iran is the first crisis. The second crisis is the peace process. We are grateful but not reassured that so far the situation in Palestine has remained somewhat under control. But we continue to believe that the current stalemate has the potential to derail or at least deeply undermine the current transitions. That's why we, and we French in particular, we strongly believe that promoting a serious peace process is as important as ever. Here again, I have no doubt that this agenda, this priority, will be pushed by France regardless of who wins the next presidential elections in my country. Finally, the third crisis we need to address is obviously Syria. This is the most pressing and distressing issue for us today, one in which we unfortunately do not have the diplomatic and military tools that we had in Libya. But I can assure you that we are working round the clock with our American partners, but also with our Arab partners, with Turkey, to support the Kofi Annan plan and to hasten a political transition in Syria. We had a large meeting yesterday with 77 actually countries in Paris focused on sanctions. We have a ministerial meeting tomorrow of the so-called core group of the Group of Friends of the Syrian People, also in Paris. We all know how difficult the equation is in Syria, but we will not give up. So I will stop here. I've already been a bit too long, as usual. And I thank you all for your attention. Merci beaucoup.
Ambassador, thank you very much. And I'm very glad that you brought in some of the wider strategic issues into the picture, particularly Iran and Syria again. Because I think it is hard to look at one without seeing the Arab Spring, or to look at the Arab Spring without seeing Iran. Because I think in many ways they're linked, and linked in the sense that we are on different sides of the issue, of the basic issue. Are you looking to have government that is responsive to the aspirations of the people, as you said? Or are you looking to have existing power structures reinforce their position and to maintain a geostrategic competition in the Middle East rather than one that transforms the Middle East into one based on shared values of freedom, democracy, human rights, and the rule of law? That's the fundamental challenge that we're facing, and so I'm glad you brought that up, because they are indeed, in my view, very closely linked. I have the pleasure now of introducing the ambassador of Tunisia. He will in turn be introducing the Minister of Finance of Tunisia. So first, allow me to wish a very warm welcome to the Minister of Finance, Houcine Dimassi. Merci, Monsieur le Ministre, d'être venu ici et de passer le temps cet après-midi avec nous. The Ambassador Tekaya, has been a great friend of Johns Hopkins and of the Center for Transatlantic Relations. If I'm not mistaken, this is the third or fourth event that we have held together now to look at different aspects of developments in Tunisia, from the election results to societal and religious change to the issues that we'll face today. And let me make one further observation. We talked about the strategic picture. We talked a little bit already about the issue of values and justice and freedom in society. But we should remember that the revolution in Tunisia started with a fruit merchant who was angry over economic issues and access to justice in the economy in Tunisia. And likewise, for those of us who would like to see success in this continued transformation in the Arab world, the ability of that transformation to succeed rests very firmly upon the economy. Do people feel that they have access to opportunity and jobs and to better lives? So I think that we have a special challenge and a special moment now to figure out when the door is open for long-term transformational change, to make sure that we are doing everything possible to make that economically and financially viable so that it is indeed successful in the long run. And with that in mind, I'm very pleased to introduce the Ambassador of Tunisia, Ambassador Tekaya, who will in turn introduce the Minister of Finance of Tunisia. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Volker. Good afternoon, dear friends and colleagues. I would like, first of all, to thank the Embassy of France and Ambassador Delattre, as well as Mrs. Jihan and the Center for Transatlantic Relations at Johns Hopkins University. Special thanks to Ambassador Walker for his kind words. And I would like to confirm the special relation of cooperation and friendship that the Embassy of Tunisia has with the Johns Hopkins University. We're proud of that cooperation, and we hope to develop it further. I would like also to thank the Alliance Française for inviting me to this important event, which is the French Embassy Rendezvous Number One, dedicated to the Arab Awakening one year later. I am particularly pleased to welcome His Excellency Houcine Dimassi, Minister of Finance of Tunisia. He has graciously accepted to join us and to share with us some thoughts about some of the challenges that Tunisia is facing, particularly in terms of unemployment and the mechanisms that the government is planning to implement in order to promote growth and jobs. Last January, the Tunisian people commemorated the first anniversary of its revolution, which was achieved to fulfill their legitimate aspirations for dignity and freedom. In 1 year, the progress in the process of democratic transition, reforms, and the fulfillment of the aspirations of the Tunisian people has been steady. However, the transition poses a number of challenges to the country. The revolution has resulted in high expectations and demands, on top of which are addressing the issue of unemployment, ensuring the recovery of the economy, which has been under pressure since the revolution, and promoting a balanced regional development. Ambassador Volker mentioned the close link between the success of the political transition, the transition to democracy, and economic development. The link is really very close, and he also recalled that the revolution was a revolution of dignity. A major milestone on the path of democracy was achieved in Tunisia last October, on October the 23rd, when Tunisia organized elections for a National Constituent Assembly. Composed of 217 members, the Assembly is responsible for key tasks which will shape the democratic future of Tunisia. And that include, in particular, drafting a new constitution, determining the future political system, and preparing for new elections. And for the first time in Tunisia, elections were organized by an independent electoral commission, as witnessed by an important number of Tunisian and international observers, including from the United States and the European Union. The elections were free, transparent, and credible. The Islamist Ennahda Movement Party came out as the big winner of the elections, garnering 89 out of 217 seats. Further steps were achieved when the new Constituent Assembly elected its speaker, a president of the republic, and a head of government belonging to different parties that won a plurality of seats at the assembly. The speaker from At-Takattul, Democratic Forum for Labor and Liberties, the president of the republic from the CPR, Congress for the Republic, and the head of the government from Ennahda Movement Party. The assembly also discussed and approved by vote the composition of a coalition government whose members come from those parties as well as independent personalities. Thus, in less than a year after the revolution, and despite the challenges it has faced, Tunisia has moved from a tightly controlled regime toward pluralism and power sharing, but the process of transition remains a long one. The Constituent Assembly has also started to draft a new constitution, and the Tunisian people expect the new constitution to establish the basis of a modern state, to anchor and protect democracy and respect for private and public freedoms, human rights, and independence of the judiciary, freedom of expression, and of the press, and freedom of belief. The Tunisian people expect also that the future constitution will preserve the achievement of the Tunisian society, namely women's rights. And concerning the issue of the place of religion in the constitution, it is worth mentioning that consensus was achieved on the inclusion in the future constitution of Article 1 of the Constitution of 1959, which defines the Tunisian identity. As for the next elections, and according to the roadmap envisaged by the government, they will take place on the 20th of March 2013, and they will be organized also by the Independent Electoral Commission. Meanwhile, the Tunisian government is pursuing the implementation of vast reforms, namely as to promote transparency, good governance, independence of the judiciary, and of regulatory institutions. It will strengthen incentives granted to investors and laws that govern investments to promote growth and create jobs. And here again, I would like to stress the fact that all these programs that have been proposed by the government are being discussed, debated in the media, in the Constituent Assembly, and the representatives of civil society have been associated also to the debate. Tunisia has achieved its revolution and made progress in its transition to democracy, and is determined to succeed, relying in the first place on its own means, and also appreciating the support of its friends and partners around the world, and in particular the United States, France, the European Union, other African and Arab countries, as well as Asian countries. And we are grateful to all those countries who have extended a helping hand to Tunisia during this difficult juncture. And their support is a contribution to the success of the Tunisian experience, which we all hope that will be a successful one. As Tunisia is engaged in its transition to democracy and benefiting from the gains of the revolution, it possesses a number of assets that reinforce its chances of success. These include a homogeneous society, a strong middle class, advanced gender equality, attachment to the values of freedom, dignity, and justice, a modern, open, and tolerant society. On the other hand, having a sound economy despite the difficulties it is facing, as well as highly educated and qualified labor force, and a strategic geographical position in the Euro-Mediterranean region, Tunisia constitutes an attractive regional economic hub. The Tunisian economy has important values, which include the sectors of tourism, textile industry, electromechanical industry, auto and plane components, information and communication technology, infrastructure, renewable energy, agribusiness, and services. And Tunisia hopes to become a financial exchange platform. And we consider Tunisia as a democracy will be an attractive place for business and tourism. And here again, I would like to stress the importance that Tunisia attaches to attracting foreign investment. We need to create jobs, we need to promote growth, and investment is highly important. And Tunisia and the Tunisian government will do everything possible in order to make it easier for investors to come to Tunisia and to do business with Tunisia. I am very glad that Minister Houcine Dimassi is with us today, because he will shed light on the budget, on the complementary budget that the government has proposed, which will give clear indication of the determination of the present government to overcome the difficulties, the economic and social difficulties that he's facing, and its success in that endeavor will certainly contribute to the success of the whole transition to democracy. And it is my honor to give the floor to Minister Houcine Dimassi. And thank you very much for your attention.
Mesdemoiselles, Mesdames, Messieurs, bonjour à tous et à toutes. Je suis vraiment très content d'être parmi vous, parce que tout d'abord, je m'adresse à des, l'élite des pays amis, et surtout à nos amis des États-Unis, mais aussi de France. Et en même temps, ça me rajeunit un peu parce que je me trouve au sein d'une institution universitaire. Et moi, je suis, de par mon métier d'origine, universitaire aussi. Donc, ça me fait énormément plaisir d'être parmi vous aujourd'hui pour débattre d'une question qui, j'espère, vous intéresse au plus haut niveau.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I'm happy to be here. You know, it's I'm happy to address a floor composed of elites from friendly countries such as the United States and France. And I feel I'm younger, and it makes me younger because I'm in a university, and by profession, I'm a university professor. So, and I thank you for your interest in discussing a subject of high priority in Tunisia.
Je suis certain que vous êtes au courant que la Tunisie, au mois de janvier 2011, a connu un bouleversement historique et surtout a réussi à éliminer un régime de dictature sans grands dégâts humains. Et ça, je crois que c'est l'une des plus grandes réussites de la Tunisie pendant les dernières décennies.
Okay, I'm certain that all you know that in Tunisia in January 2011, Tunisia witnessed a historic change. It succeeded to get rid of one of the worst dictatorial regime, and this is one of the biggest achievements in the modern history of Tunisia, or the greatest achievement in the modern history of Tunisia.
Du point de vue politique, la Tunisie évolue dans le sens positif du terme, puisque depuis la Révolution, nous avons réussi à élaborer, à organiser des élections pour la première fois dans l'histoire de mon pays, libre et démocratique, ce qui est très important comme événement. Nous avons élu une assemblée constituante qui est actuellement en train d'élaborer la première aussi constitution démocratique au vrai sens du terme.
Okay, on the political level, Tunisia has moved in the positive direction. Since the revolution, we succeeded to organize free and democratic elections, which is something very important. We elected a National Constituent Assembly that is driving, in fact, the first democratic constitution ever.
Cela n'empêche que aujourd'hui, nous faisons face à d'énormes contraintes sur le plan social et économique.
Nonetheless, nowadays we're confronting enormous challenges in on the social and economic levels.
Cela, bien sûr, nous contraint, nous pousse à choisir la méthode de gouvernance la plus rationnelle et la moins dangereuse pour le devenir de mon pays.
Okay, so this is certainly forces us to choose the most rational form of governing the country, Tunisia.
Sans rentrer dans le détail, je vous donne quelques exemples des énormes contraintes socio-économiques auxquelles on s'expose. Et qui, bien sûr, en nous verrons tout à l'heure, nécessite un soutien très important de la part de nos amis, des pays amis et frères. Je cite quatre exemples, tout simplement, de défis socio-économiques pour vous donner un petit peu sur la phase de transition difficile que nous sommes en train de traverser.
Okay, so notwithstanding details, we face enormous social-economic constraints, and that really requires the support of our friendly and brotherly countries. So he's going to talk about those four main challenges.
La première et la plus importante de ces contraintes, c'est l'énorme masse d'attentes sociales révélées justement par la révolution. C'est-à-dire que ces contraintes et ces attentes sociales énormes sont demeurées pendant des décennies déguisées, cachées. Et ces attentes ont explosé tout d'un coup, brutalement, ce qui a bien sûr généré, je répète, une contrainte éminemment importante sur le plan social et économique. Bien sûr, lorsque je dis attente sociale, j'entends par là essentiellement le chômage, qui demeure important dans notre pays, l'emploi précaire aussi, sous toutes ses formes, et aussi des poches de pauvreté qui persistent dans certaines régions du pays, et surtout les régions qui étaient très longtemps marginalisées.
So, the first and big challenge is the huge mass of social demands that the revolution actually broke out. They were disguised, they were hidden in the former regime, and that the revolution emanated that imminent constraint. So, essentially, this challenge is joblessness and job creation, a precarious employment situation for many Tunisians, and poverty pockets in disenfranchised and land zones, especially in Tunisia.
Cette contrainte sociale s'avère encore plus aiguë lorsqu'on parle du chômage des jeunes diplômés. C'est vraiment la contrainte et le danger le plus grave qui se pose justement dans notre pays aujourd'hui. Pourquoi? Parce que l'ancien régime a mis en place un système éducatif en dysfonctionnement avec le besoin justement du marché de l'emploi. C'est-à-dire ce système éducatif génère un flux de diplômés de supérieurs largement supérieur aux capacités du marché à absorber des diplômés du supérieur. Ce qui a fait petit à petit un surplus de diplômés qui trouvent difficilement de l'emploi et qui, bien sûr, deviennent une source de déstabilisation sociale du pays.
So these constraints, or this constraint, is all the more acute when it comes with to the unemployment of the young graduates in Tunisia. This is actually the most dangerous aspect to look at, because the old regime has put an educational system that wasn't synchronous with the needs of the market. So you had people who were coming out of the universities that the market could not absorb. So this created a surplus, and it's actually a very big source of destabilization, a social destabilization in Tunisia.
La seconde importante contrainte à laquelle on fait face, et dont on parle moins que le chômage, surtout des diplômés, c'est justement la question de la lourde charge de caisse de compensation. En Tunisie, nous avons une caisse de compensation destinée à soutenir, à compenser les carburants, les produits alimentaires de base et le transport scolaire. Pourquoi on en parle comme contrainte principale à laquelle il faut réfléchir et à laquelle il faut trouver des solutions? Parce que c'est une caisse qui absorbe une très grande partie des ressources de l'État. Je vous donne un simple exemple. Aujourd'hui, cette caisse absorbe environ 6 milliards de dinars tunisiens, ce qui est l'équivalent, ça c'est très important, l'équivalent de budget de l'équipement de l'État. C'est très significatif et très important.
Okay. So the second constraint that we speak about less is the heavy charge of the what we call the fund of compensation. It's in Tunisia, everything, you know, the hydro, you know, fuels is the hydro fuels, the basic products such as bread, flour, etc., and the school transportation are actually, you know, subsidized by the state. So this absorbs a major chunk of the state budget, which is about 6 billion Tunisian dinars. It's about $4 billion. And this is actually equivalent to the budget of the Ministry of Equipment, our Ministry of Public Constructions, so which gives you an idea about.
Cette question de caisse de compensation est difficile à traiter pour une simple raison que ça touche des catégories sociales généralement démunies et donc son traitement soulève des craintes sociales et même politiques très importantes. C'est pour cela que c'est une question très importante. Le poids sur les ressources de l'État sont énormes, mais il n'est pas facile du tout de gérer et surtout de traiter cette question afin de la temporiser et de la rendre acceptable. Pourquoi ? Parce qu'elle suscite des sensibilités sur le plan, je répète, social, économique et politique énormément délicates.
So this is really difficult to deal with because this compensation actually goes directly to those who are, you know, in real need in Tunisia. And this becomes a really difficult social and political questions, so we really need to know and to find the ways to manage the situation in a very careful manner.
La troisième contrainte, c'est le remboursement de la dette publique fort contraignant, surtout pendant les trois prochaines années, c'est-à-dire 2012, 2013, 2014, résultant du fait que l'ancien régime a contracté durant des années, des emprunts généralement lourds et qui sont, en termes de principal, le principal de la dette, remboursable en une seule fois, en un paquet. Et donc, nous avons la malchance d'affronter la nouvelle étape, après la Révolution, justement le remboursement d'une série d'emprunts qui ont été contractés au début de la décennie antérieure, et donc ça représente pour nous un énorme défi, une énorme contrainte qu'il faut gérer intelligemment. La dernière contrainte, s'il vous plaît. Oui.
So, the third constraint is the reimbursement of the public debt for the next 3 years, actually 2012, 2013, and 2014, because the old regime has contracted big loans that at the beginning of the years 2000 and that are payable now, so we have the bad luck to confront this situation right now after the revolution.
La quatrième et dernière contrainte relève justement de la consolidation de l'infrastructure de base du pays, routes, autoroutes, ports, aéroports, etc., équipements collectifs, hôpitaux, écoles, universités, etc., pour la simple raison qu'on a accusé un certain retard durant les deux dernières décennies et que nous sommes tenus justement à rattraper ce retard et à consolider de manière significative cette infrastructure de base du pays. Lorsqu'on voit de plus près ces quatre contraintes, ça veut dire quoi? Ça veut dire qu'aujourd'hui, nous sommes tenus.
All right. So the fourth constraint is actually to consolidate the basic infrastructure in the country, meaning ports, airports, roads, dams, etc. Because we were lagging behind in this level during the past two decades. So we need now to make up for this delay, and he's going to explain what this means.
Ces quatre contraintes signifient que dans la Tunisie post-révolutionnaire, nous sommes face à un défi énorme qui consiste à satisfaire, répondre au plus possible, au maximum des attentes sociales, d'une part, à préparer la relance de l'économie sur des bases solides pour l'avenir, à travers les investissements dans l'infrastructure, les équipements collectifs, et ainsi de suite. D'autre part, sans laisser gravement et outre mesure dans l'endettement. C'est ça la problématique et le défi énorme auquel on doit faire face dans les années à venir.
Okay, so these four constraints in the post-revolutionary Tunisia, what they mean exactly is actually we're confronting a challenging situation. On the one hand, we have to respond to the pressing social demands, and how to we can reboost the economy through building new infrastructure, etc., and without actually contracting huge debts in order not to lose the big equilibrium, the general equilibrium. So this is the main, really, question.
Ce défi suppose pour sa réussite deux principales conditions. La première de ces conditions, c'est la mobilisation du maximum de ressources internes propres. Je répète, la mobilisation du maximum de ressources internes propres, c'est-à-dire propres au pays. Et bien sûr, ça va de soi, cela impose un minimum d'austérité pendant les années à venir. C'est le prix à payer pour réussir justement cette stratégie.
Okay, so what this actually challenge entails, it entails two conditions. The first one is the mobilization of the maximum of internal resources. And in order to be able to do that, we have to actually do it through austerity. So there is no way to do it without actually shrinking, the public expenses and actually going down the path of austerity.
La seconde de ces conditions, c'est l'appui plus consistant de nos frères et amis, des pays frères et amis, sous toute forme possible, prêts à des conditions acceptables modérées, effacement de quelques dettes antérieures, investissement direct ou par projet stratégique intéressant, etc. Mais en tout cas, cet appui est absolument nécessaire pour que le devenir de la Tunisie soit une réussite.
All right. So the second condition is actually the support of our friendly and brotherly countries in any way or shape. It could be in the form of soft loans, debt forgiveness, foreign direct investment, strategic projects. So this is actually very welcome.
Je termine pour dire que la réussite de l'expérience et de la révolution tunisienne sera une référence pour le reste des pays de la région. Mais en même temps aussi, c'est l'échec qui risque justement de remettre en cause l'ensemble des expériences de transition actuellement en mouvement et en ébullition dans le monde arabe et dans la rive sud de la Méditerranée d'une façon plus précise.
Okay.
Oui.
Okay. So I would like to conclude with underlining that the success of the Tunisian transition will be a reference to all other countries in the region. And God forbid if it's this transition is put into question, and so all the other Arab transitions are at risk. And not only that, but even the southern shore of the Mediterranean too.
La Tunisie, c'est le pays qui pourrait être le champ de réussite d'un modèle modéré, équilibré, vivable et viable. Je répète, la Tunisie constitue un pays, vu justement ses spécificités, vu son histoire, vu ses atouts, dont a parlé notre ami l'ambassadeur tout à l'heure, constitue parmi les rares, sinon l'unique pays dans la région capable de faire réussir un modèle, je répète, modéré, équilibré, vivable et viable.
Okay.
Si dans ce pays on échoue dans l'élaboration et la réussite de ce modèle, on risque de rater tout le mouvement de libération, de démocratisation de la région.
Okay, so I would like to reiterate that Tunisia is the country that could be the moderate, balanced, viable, and livable model in the region. And I would say this is one of the few, if not the unique, capable model to succeed in the region in presenting a moderate, balanced, viable, and livable model. And if we fail again, we risk to lose all the benefits that are coming out of that movement in the Arab world.
Construire une société civile, pas religieuse, civile. Et cela résulte du fait que même Nahda, qui est considéré le parti, la tendance la plus, disons, religieuse, a pris position nette et claire, pas de charia comme base d'inspiration pour la nouvelle constitution. Et cela prouve pour une fois, encore dans l'histoire de la Tunisie, que c'est un pays de modération et d'équilibre. Et je vous remercie énormément.
Okay, so. I think you understood. I don't need to translate, right? So, just for those who, you know, need that. Just a basic historic fact, Tunisia has never been a land of extremism. If you look throughout Tunisia's history, we've never been a country where religious extremism took refuge. The proof that even lately, after a passionate debate, all the political forces agreed to build a civil, not a religious society. Even another party, which has religious reference, took a clear position that no Sharia should be inserted in the new constitution. And that proves again that Tunisia is a land of moderation. Thank you very much.
Monsieur le ministre, merci beaucoup. Merci pour votre intervention qui était très claire. Vous entendez maintenant. Merci pour votre parole. Je trouve que votre vision pour la Tunisie était très claire et très impressionnante. Merci pour ça. Thank you very much for a very clear presentation, a very clear vision about where Tunisia is going. We have time for just a couple of questions because the minister and the ambassador need to head on to other appointments. I know what I would like to ask, but I would like to first give the opportunity to the audience for those who might have questions for the minister. Let me turn first. I'll take three questions, if we can do it that way, and then turn back to the minister. Okay. Bob Beecroft.
Mr. Minister, Mr. Ambassador, thank you very much for a presentation that I think gives us reason for encouragement. Minister Dimassi mentioned that Tunisia could serve as a model for other countries undergoing this process. I think of your next door neighbor, Libya. I know that the focus has been on Tunisia, but the focus of the conference was also on the Arab awakening. How can Libya be influenced in a positive way by what has already taken place in Tunisia, and what initiatives has Tunisia begun to spread its experience in a positive sense to what is going on in a much more disorganized and chaotic way next door, which obviously must have a serious preoccupations from the point of view of your own government. Okay. Thank you.
And then behind you, two rows, Bob, if you can pass it back.
Thank you very much. Mr. Minister, you are perfectly right. I mean, foreign direct investment is absolutely essential for Tunisia to generate activity and to generate employment. Now, it is important for that purpose to improve the business climate, which was not a good investment destination during the Ben Ali years. So what has been done by the new government to improve attractiveness of Tunisia for investment? And second, do you see signs of new investment coming to Tunisia? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so question on investment. And then finally, I see two hands now, so I'll take both. So first on the far end. Okay, we'll take the. Please.
Thank you very much. The finance minister mentioned the the issue of education, the fact that there has been a rather dysfunctional education system in recent years, and that students are not being trained, that the system is not geared toward the needs of the market, and this is influencing the unemployment rate. What is being done, what can be done by the US, France, Europe, and others to assist in education reform, to engage in more educational exchanges, to provide scholarships, to help that system adjust itself to the needs of the marketplace?
Okay, and then right there as well.
I'm looking at a website, Tunisia Live. It says that the Association of Tunisian Judges announced that its members will be wearing red armbands today to protest what they call, quote, the reluctance and the lack of will from the government to reform the judiciary. And it quotes the head of the Association of Tunisian Jurists claiming that the regime is beginning to act like the former regime. I appreciate your comments.
Okay. I want to turn to the minister to give a chance to answer these questions that have been raised. We'll see how we do on time. Merci, Madame la ministre.
La question sur le rapport Libye-Tunisie est une question extrêmement importante pour trois raisons. Tout d'abord, pour la Tunisie, la Libye constitue un partenaire de premier choix. Et donc, par la nécessité des choses, elle doit contribuer à la stabilité dans ce pays. Nous avons énormément d'intérêts et nos frères les Libyens ont aussi énormément d'intérêts en Tunisie. Donc, nous sommes deux partenaires de choix dans la région. Malheureusement, la situation en Libye demeure encore floue et incertaine. Et d'ailleurs, c'est pour cette raison que je dis la réussite de la Tunisie constitue l'une des conditions de la réussite de l'ensemble du mouvement de démocratisation dans la région. Parce qu'on peut imaginer la situation inverse. L'état de la Libye actuellement, si la Tunisie, son voisin le plus important, le plus influent, les intérêts les plus importants, ne réussit pas, lui, à se construire sa propre démocratie, je crois que ce sera sans doute un début de chaos à l'échelle de toute la région. C'est pour cette raison que j'ai dit la réussite de l'exemple tunisien est quelque chose de fondamental. Pour terminer, la Libye pose encore beaucoup de problèmes. Pourquoi ? Pour une raison au moins. Ce que Gaddafi, le drame de la Libye de Gaddafi, c'est que l'État a presque disparu. Il n'y a plus d'État. La Tunisie a eu cette chance historique, hein, c'est que toujours il y a un État. Toujours, quelles que soient les difficultés, quelle que soit l'instabilité, toujours il y avait un État. Donc, se reconstituer était beaucoup plus facile que dans un pays où il y a presque absence totale d'État. Et c'est pour cela que la situation en Libye demeure, je répète encore une fois, incertaine. Mais bien sûr, nous pensons, nous, Tunisiens, à ce que les choses s'améliorent et se rétablissent sur de nouvelles bases le plus tôt possible dans ce pays. Concernant... bien sûr,
okay.
Pardon.
So, for the Libya-Tunisia question, thank you, this is a very important question. Libya is actually a partner of a first-rate partner of Tunisia. It has to contribute, we have to contribute to its stability. We have big interests in Libya, and our Libyan brothers have big interests in Tunisia, but unfortunately, the situation there has been uncertain. This is why I said that the success of the Tunisian example is so crucial to serve as a model for the Libyans and beyond Libya. You know, if Tunisia doesn't succeed, I think I have no doubt actually that it's going to be the start of a chaotic situation in the whole region. Why Libya actually poses a problem? Because There is no state. Gaddafi left that country with no state. In Tunisia, we have had the chance and the fortune that we have always had a state in Tunisia, no matter what the regime was. We always had a state that was there. So it's much, it was much easier for us to pull ourselves together in Tunisia than in Libya. But I, you know, remain convinced that after a while and with our own help, that the situation in Libya can get back to normalcy.
La question concernant comment peut-on favoriser un climat le plus favorable possible pour les investissements directs étrangers. Ça aussi, c'est une question fondamentale. Et d'ailleurs, qui explique pourquoi nous faisons face à une situation de transition énormément délicate. Pourquoi? Parce que pour pouvoir instaurer la stabilité et la sécurité sociale, qui est la condition fondamentale pour attirer le maximum possible d'investissements directs étrangers, qui justement constitue l'une des conditions pour améliorer les conditions de vie et surtout réduire le chômage. C'est pour cette raison que nous sommes aujourd'hui contraints et obligés de créer parfois des emplois pas nécessairement productifs. Leur but fondamental, leur but, c'est d'absorber le plus possible de colère et d'inquiétude des jeunes en chômage, en attendant justement à ce que la stabilité mène assez d'investissements pour pouvoir créer le maximum possible de vrais emplois, des emplois productifs. Cette équation est absolument délicate à gérer. Et c'est pour cela, je répète encore une fois, que l'appui des pays amis est absolument fondamental et nécessaire dans cette conjoncture. Parce qu'avec nos propres moyens, nous ne pouvons pas mener en parallèle efficacement le productif et l'improductif, le nécessaire et le moins nécessaire, l'urgent et le moyen et à long terme. Gérer cette équation, on ne peut pas le faire tout seul. Nous sommes un pays à moyens réduits, à moyens limités. L'appui de nos amis est absolument nécessaire dans cette étape.
Okay, so for the second question, how we can build a favorable climate to attract FDIs. It's actually in order to attract more FDIs, we need to ensure stability. So we found a way in order to create stability. We were obliged to create jobs, not necessarily productive. Sometimes they are unproductive, but just to quell the ire of and the expectations of the young people. So to stabilize the environment and we can focus on creating viable and long-term projects in order to create jobs. So this is why the support of our friends is crucial, because in Tunisia we do not have the means to actually manage at the same time the productive and non-productive, the urgent and less urgent. We are a small country with small and limited resources, and that's why your support is very much appreciated and needed.
I'm informed that Monsieur le Ministre, vous avez d'autres réunions.
Oui.
He has other meetings that he needs to get to, and while I would love to have him continue to address these questions, it perhaps is even more important that he go off and solve these questions. So thank you very much for spending the time with us. Thank you for these insights. It is tremendously impressive, I think, for all of us to hear the clarity of your perspective. And we wish you all of the best as you go and seek to do this. And I certainly know that all of us will be wishing you well and seeing where, in any small ways, we may be able to contribute to success that you have in Tunisia. So thank you very much, Mr. Ministre. We'll be organizing for a second panel once the minister departs. So thank you.